Many whitewater paddlers are most comfortable in their boats and have somewhat of a difficult time navigating around on dry land. Some boaters are poverty-stricken students building strong bodies with unconventional diets. And many have short attention spans, making it difficult to concentrate on the task at hand. Some even forget their planned route through a previously scouted rapid. But let's give them some credit. Most know when to swallow their pride and take steps to avoid a tenuous situation. One of the earliest known sit-on-top kayaks. Although most find them difficult to stay on in rapids, they are easy to escape from and easy to get back into after an upset. Here's Fran Cutter, unintentionally introducing the paddle twirl to the sport. It's generally a good idea to practice some warm-up rolls in the calmer sections of the river one's running, but it's a little puzzling to determine what use a snorkel would serve while rolling a kayak. The trick with beginners training trips is having a high teacher-to-student ratio. If anything can go wrong, it will go wrong, and at the worst possible time. Murphy's Law must have been postulated by kayakers. In the earliest days of the sport, not everyone wore helmets, and some even argued that life jackets were dangerous. Hard to believe in light of boating as we know it today. Probably your typical kayaker's front yard. Lawn care, definitely not on the minds of the occupants of this house. Neighbors are probably already complaining about property values. Many boaters use these large vans on boating vacations to spread travel expenses over a large group. This van appears to be packed to the rafters. Let's see how many are crammed inside. Careful, honey, that pavement looks hot. Must be a couple of sets of twins along on this trip. Triplets? Hey, wait a minute! Most kayakers have heard of the atomic launch. Well, here's a subatomic launch. Looks like more boats than water. Here's Jerry Smith up that well-known creek without a paddle. In this case, that well-known creek is the Electra Run on the McCollumy River. It's always good to have competent help along to retrieve gear if necessary. Stanislaus Camp 9 run, which now lies submerged under the reservoir created by the new Don Pedro Dam, there was a rapid with one hell of a stopper wave. It was known to stop and hold many an unwary kayaker or two, sometimes simultaneously. One way to avoid a hot seat at the lunch stop is to sit in a cool pool. Without the conveniences of home, like a cutting board for example, a paddler can hurt himself trying to rustle up a sandwich at lunchtime. Here's a couple who've managed to bring along quite a few more creature comforts from the old homestead, much to the astonishment and or envy of their tripmates. Thank you. what's missing are some manners. Oh well, what can you expect from the whitewater crowd? Here's a brand new canoe getting a proper christening. I've never known a boater, however, who could stand seeing a good bottle of champagne going to waste. If you're going to christen anything, how about christening my mouth? The earliest days of kayak surfing were at best a kind of trial and error experience. Non-boaters were even known to ask if paddlers would stand in their boats while surfing. Well, stand no, but sit on rather than in, well, maybe. It was a fairly widely held belief that open canoes could not negotiate Class 3 whitewater. Here is a tandem lending credence to that notion. Rafting and raft support require the help of all trip members. I should emphasize, competent help. Here, the breakfast chef drums a cool riff to the accompaniment of burning bacon. Rafting affords one many of the conveniences of home. Here we see the blender pressed into service. On the old Camp 9 run of the Stanislaus, a short hike up Rose Creek would bring one to this pleasant oasis. Abandonment of youth. Caution isn't always the safest course of action. This usually leads to this. Some adventure seekers choose to cast their fate to experienced outfitters whose skill and judgment one might wonder about. Just better hope you don't end up on a trip with a wretched rafting company. This hapless crew finds itself sucked back into the hole at the bottom of Clavey Rapid on the Tuolumne River. In some cases, the boat acts like the ball in a pinball machine. This commercial trip's kitchen raft attempts a secondary chute down Rainy Falls on the Rogue River. When running steep, rocky drops, you leave the oars in the water at your own peril. If you're not careful, you can get beamed. No one's rattled here, however, as you see them putting two oars on one tow pin. Here's an alternative, albeit questionable, choice through Rainy Falls. The lightly loaded raft gets folded taco style at the base of the drop. Getting pole vaulted from your seat is another consequence of oar placement, as is demonstrated by Steve Cochran on the Eel River's Middle Fork. With only one oar at his disposal, he is at the mercy of the river. Once the boat fills up, it will flush through. Throwing caution to the wind, Mike Cochran holds on for dear life running his Huck Finn-style raft over the main drop of Rainy Falls. Notice that several gear bags come loose. As Mike struggles to get back on board, he gets keel-hauled when he hits a submerged rock and the boat runs over him. Let's see who all most likely owned the gear bags that went overboard earlier. These pool toys and drugstore type rafts are referred to by serious boaters as kamikaze kits. This group of paddle rafters really has their act together. And this group is just keeping up appearances. Yeah, that was exactly the way we intended to run this rapid. Organizers of early downriver races utilized the Monte Carlo-style mass start. As you can see, racing degenerated, and it wasn't long before the lowriders got involved. The so-called expert boaters are constantly aware of each other's presence. They have precise control over their boats and are never surprised by the river's hydraulics. They can park their boats in minute eddies where eddies seemingly don't exist. They can be counted on to pull off that crucial move whenever required. They utilize the river's obstacles to steer their way down through the rapids. And if all that is not enough, they just bulldoze their way downriver. Heard enough? Actually, most successes running rivers are due to dumb luck as due to anything else. As has been said, I'd rather be lucky than good any day of the week. As was mentioned in this program's subtitle, A Decade of Dubious Whitewater Achievement, the emphasis on dubious should by now be obvious. Synchronized kayaking, by two of the three boaters depicted at least. As to the odd man out, he might still be groggy from his run-in in the previous scene. This brings us to Chamberlain Falls on the North Fork of the American River. Like a lot of named rapids and river locations, the names given these places by kayakers and rafters are usually the result of some kind of debacle that at one time took place there. This kind of thing usually becomes the stuff of legend, but the incidents are rarely caught on film. Not so this time, however. Mike Chamberlain gets wiped off the rock he's clinging to like a fly being swatted off a horse's back. Walt Harvest, who filmed this scene, advised Mike to backpedal over the drop, then filmed away gleefully at the upcoming hilarity. I'm sure Mike didn't share in Walt's glee. Backpedaling over a drop intentionally gets this boater a submarine-style ride and an infusion of water into his wetsuit. Sometimes expert boaters bend the rules a little. Here a kayaker dumps in a rapid in spite of signs posted to the contrary. If you're not paying attention, there's a rapid on the Locksaw River in Idaho that is sure to grab it, as well as the private parts that you hold so dear to your heart. Let's see how long Pat Mallory tries to keep from getting his lunch eaten by this Mongo stopper wave. Imitation. The highest form of flattery. No longer does it seem that canoers and kayakers are content to merely paddle down a river. No, it seems they've become obsessed with aerobatics. And what better way to get some air than to paddle over obstacles like dams, spillways, rocks, or what have you? Canoeists are equally intent on this airborne thing. However, their challenge is made all the more difficult by a lack of hull speed relative to kayakers. But so determined are canoeists to join in on the fun, they will not be denied. Similar to aviation, being airborne is one thing. Landing is quite another thing. And like aviation, any landing that you can walk or swim away from is a good thing. So alluring has this desire to fly become that in drought years, some have forsaken their boats altogether and have taken to the air through a novel approach. Throw together some bamboo, plastic, duct tape, and baling wire, and voila, you've got yourself a hang glider. True, such an aircraft would nearly have to be reconstructed after each takeoff attempt, not to mention it being wiser to have the pilot rather than a launch assistant wearing the helmet. Better yet, have the assistant, already wearing the helmet, and who is 35 pounds lighter, pilot the aircraft. Note that during takeoff, it doesn't help to push up on the trailing edge of the wing. Limited success is achieved at last, although no one could have imagined the consequences of a complete success owing to the depth of the canyon beyond. Over time, materials and engineering evolved. Unfortunately, flyers did not. What can be said is that flying downwind with the reduced lift encountered over water can lead to unpredictable and surprising results. The bottom line? In hang gliding and kayaking alike, what you often end up with is wet tennies.